Good morning. Welcome to Living Well Livestream Studio. My name is Bill. It's nice to be with you today. We're going to worship together, learn from the book, the good book. We're going to be in Nehemiah today, in chapter 8, and then a little bit in chapter 9. Nehemiah, chapter 8 and chapter 9. This, in a sense, goes along with the book of Ezra, talking about the rebuilding of the wall. So let's go ahead and meet our Lord in prayer, and then we'll get into his word today. Thank you for joining us. Mighty God, our Heavenly Father, thank you once again for helping us to set aside this time and learn from your inspired word. It's no accident that we're together here this morning, God. And we know you're right in the midst of us, because it says wherever two or more are gathered. And that is not dependent upon distance, even though ones are watching from home, people are here. You are outside of all of that. You're bigger than all of it. So you're in our midst ministering to us as we look at your word today. So we ask that you bless our time here in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, it starts out talking about sacred texts, different religions and different forms of religions have their sacred texts and how they treat them. The book of Torah, for example, the Jewish Torah, which is the first five books of the old Jewish or the Hebrew Bible. And it's also what Christians call the Pentateuch, the Old Testament, the first five books. The way that the people treat that is very interesting. The Jewish Torah may never be placed upside down or on the ground, nor is anything to be laid on top of it. If the Torah is being transported, it must be held. It should never be put like on a car seat or up on the dash. A passenger needs to hold it, and never in the trunk. Just thought I'd add that. It says if it's in a home, if you walk into the room where this is at, the Torah, you are to be dressed, and you must be behaving respectfully in the room where that is at. Very interesting, isn't it? So generally, obviously, it's never left in a bedroom or a bathroom where one might be out of attire. So it is generally kept in more of a public place in the house. You would always be dressed and acting respectfully around it. Now it says when it is being carried by a person, if you're walking with it, you announce it. Or if the people know it, they must stand until it reaches its destination and is put down. Very interesting, isn't it? Now, have you heard of the Quran? That's an Islamic sacred book. They believe it was dictated to Muhammad by the angel Gabriel. It says the Quran must never be taken into a bathroom and, again, not laid on any floor. If you write in the Quran, that is strictly forbidden. You do not mark it up. It says if you are copying anything from the Quran, you must use clear, elegant handwriting. And if you are reading it, especially speaking aloud, you must use a clear, beautiful voice. So I guess I'm out. It says copies that have been defiled for any reason must be wrapped in cloth and buried in a hole and placed in water until the ink runs, or it must be burned. Very interesting. And this is what the text has given me. So it asks a question to start with all of this talk of how others treat their sacred texts. How do we show respect for our Bible? We use it. We use it. Yeah, we apply it, don't we? We do write in the Bible. If that helps you with your worship, if that helps you become a better Christian, more Christ-like, that is your goal, it is condoned to mark passages that are special to you or to write a little note in there, and that is for clarification. Something makes sense to you and help you remember it. Now, to ask the question, is our familiarity with the Bible a positive or a negative thing, and why? If you're familiar with the Bible, is that a positive or a negative thing, and why? That's an interesting question. Yeah, there's a mic up there. I think it'll work. Hopefully God blesses it.
I'd say there's two different ways you can be familiar with something. You know, because there's sort of that familiarity breeds contempt sort of idea. But then the other side of it is, if you're familiar with it and in a positive way, then you're applying it and living it out, and you know it enough so that it comes to your mind whenever you need it.
I'm glad you mentioned the word apply it. Can one be familiar with the Bible and not apply it? An example would be Satan. Can recite the Bible. He's been around long enough, a lot longer than us, that we know of, obviously. He can recite things out of there. Of course, he misquotes, misuses, does not apply. Can you speak words of the Bible and harm someone? Yes, you can be very familiar with the word and speak out of contempt and not of love, or out of pride to show how smart you are, to try to get your own props. But as our brother said, applying it. So familiarity with the Bible is a very positive thing if you are applying it. There are many walking, talking Christians, and I wouldn't say an overwhelming majority, because that paints a very negative picture. But just to be sure, there are many Christians who can speak Bible-ese but don't apply it. And God willing, what happens then is their lives, then something happens in their life where it becomes apparent that they're not applying it. They get caught in a sin or something happens. That glaring need to apply it becomes evident, and the Spirit gives them conviction. And all this is done out of love, because God loves us, but He wants the best for us. Then they start to do it in a positive fashion, and they apply it, thank God. But there are many people who can speak Bible-ese, Christian-ese, that aren't applying it. So our relationship with our Bible is a matter of the heart. It always comes back to the heart and application. Today we see how the Israelites had neglected the Word of God and how reconnection with the Word of God prompted repentance. So our first reading today is in Nehemiah chapter 8, verses 5 through 12. Do I have a volunteer this morning? That would be fantastic. Mr. Mark, have at it. Chapter 8, verses 5 through 12.
Ezra opened the book. All the people could see him because he was standing above them, and as he opened it, the people all stood up. Ezra praised the Lord, the great God, and all the people lifted their hands and responded, "Amen, amen." Then they bowed down and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. The Levites, Jeshua, Benai, Sherebiah, Jamin, Akub, Shebathiah, Hodiah, Messiah, Kalita, Azariah, Josabad, Hanan, and Peliah instructed the people in the law while the people were standing there. They read from the book of the law of God, making it clear and giving the meaning so that the people understood what was being read.
Yeah, 5 through 12. Yeah, it's a big, you have the big one today. You go all the way down that first page.
Then Nehemiah the governor, Ezra the priest, and the teacher of the law, and the Levites who were instructing the people said to them all, This day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep. For all the people had been weeping as they listened to the words of the law. Nehemiah said, go and enjoy choice food and sweet drinks, and send some to those who have nothing prepared. This day is holy to our Lord. Do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. The Levites calmed all the people, saying, be still, for this is a holy day. Do not grieve. Then all the people went away to eat and drink, to send portions of food, and to celebrate with great joy, because they now understood the words that had been made known to them.
Very good. Good job with all those names, too. Could have just said those guys. Yep. I mean, I appreciate that the Bible is so specific at times, and it mentions them by name. But for a lot of us, it could have just went from the Levites instructed them instead of going through. But no, I am glad that it does do that. It appropriately pays attention to detail. Now it says, the events of Ezra 8 occurred after the wall was restored and the Israelites had returned to their own towns. It says, then they reassembled in Jerusalem. Of course, we're reading from Nehemiah. So it asks, why do you think they waited until now to bring out the book of the law of Moses for public reading? Boy, they ask a big one right out the gate, don't they? That was in my head as I was reading this morning. Because I'm always thinking, what's the big deal? Why are they doing that? What's the meaning behind that? And they asked it right out the gate. Why do you think they waited until now to bring out the book of law of Moses for public reading? Remember, they had to assemble. They were worried about enemies. They built the wall with a weapon in hand. They did all these things. They went back to their own places after the building, and then they came back and reassembled and then read the law. Why do you think they waited until now to do that? That's an interesting question, isn't it? Very interesting. Why do you think that was, or was there any benefit to it? Maybe look at it that way. How did that benefit them? Any thoughts on that? You got some, Mike?
Somewhere in that reading, I saw something about the people they wept. And, you know, I just think about how when something really touches us and we really grasp a meaning of it, how a lot of times it'll bring tears to your eyes, you know? And so as the people were hearing this being read, there was real emotion and real something happening, you know? And would it have been that way had they just got the book out and read it while there's enemies on the side here and they're worried about this and that there, you know? They got everything ready so that there was safety on all sides and where they could really focus on what they'd just been through and all that, and God prepared it, and then it was the time to read the scripture.
Any other thoughts on that? It definitely did provide them a place and a sense of refuge where they could more safely gather together, as our brother said, of safety. You ever heard the term house in order? Get your house in order. I see some nods. A lot of times, Christians step out meaning well and well-meaning, and they go do a lot of outreach. They go do a lot of things for the church, but their house is not in order. Are they as effective in their worship and outreach? Generally not. The Bible encourages to put your house in order. Get connected with God, get your house in order, then reach out. These people, as we said, had to be inspired to start with. So their leader, with the help of the good Lord and the Holy Spirit, which had already been doing work in their hearts, inspired them to do this work. They got together, they worked, sometimes again, weapons in hand, and did this great feat in like a record time. And it was obvious that God was involved. They went back to their places, came back. Everything was in order, as our brother said. The house was in order. They were actually ready now to take the next step. As he had said before, they might not as likely have had their hearts as receptive and open. They're standing in the midst of all this work that they did. They realize the importance of it. It's done. They felt good about it. They did all of the stuff, accomplished it with the Lord. Now they're learning, as their hearts are receptive, how they had fallen into transgression. I see you all looking. Now they were learning some of the truths about themselves. And before, with the distractions and things going on and the safety that wasn't there, their house wasn't in order, the temple walls, I'm using both of them interchangeably, it just wasn't the right time. But now they had a safe place, their house was in order. It says, note that after Ezra read, numerous Levites, again, who we were blessed to hear the names of, instructed the people for clear understanding. It asks the question, why did the chosen people of God, these are God's chosen people, why did they require so much explanation? I mean, Satan knows the words.
Most of them couldn't read back then. So
most of them couldn't read.
If they can't read, it would be hard to comprehend.
That would be a start. Yep. And they generally didn't read the texts anyway. A lot of it was oral, verbal tradition. So were they likely going to any worship services? Probably not. They weren't hearing these words.
They'd also been living among people speaking a different language. And so, you know, yeah, they knew their, probably knew their Hebrew, but they also, the words that they were hearing on a daily basis had a different focus.
Absolutely. They were very distracted. A lot of pagan things going on. They had intermarried with Gentiles, which just, it sounds like a bad name, but it's just people who weren't part of that Jewish family, lineage. But they were intermarrying with other people, taking on their beliefs, getting distracted, as our brother said, not focusing. They weren't able to read, as Brother Mark had said, and they obviously weren't going anywhere where they heard anything. So they were just grossly out of practice and out of touch. What does this say about Christians today? And neglect of the word. What will happen to you if you neglect the word? Because remember, this is applicable now. They're people just like we're people. If you're not getting into your Bible daily in one form or another, what does that say about what could likely happen to you then? You could start to get out of touch. Could start to forget the meanings. Yes. May not understand meanings. Yep, you become more calloused to that God's gentleman voice. He's a gentleman. He generally doesn't scream at you. He speaks in a soft voice. You can start to get calloused, in a sense, lose your hearing. It says, when Ezra opened the book, why did all of the people stand up? Well, it's usually pretty easy. They did it out of respect and worship, didn't they? Yeah, respect. But it also says that maybe some wanted to hear better. I don't know about that, but it says, what are some other practices in our culture for which people spontaneously stand? National anthem's a big one. Yep. Anything to do with the flag a lot of times, standing up and saluting, especially in the military. You generally don't sit and salute. Yep. As soon as a CEO or somebody walks in, one person, the first person to see them, the first person to see that highest ranking officer come in that room yells, "Room, attention." And everybody snaps. It doesn't matter if there's 750 people in there or three people in there. Everybody snaps. Everybody's whoosh, until it's returned. It's done out of respect. And it says, obviously, in the entrance of a dignitary or someone of high ranking. So it asks the question, which is interesting, why did we not stand today for the reading of the scripture a few moments ago? There's nothing negative. It's just ask the question. Why was it that we didn't stand a few moments ago when Brother Mark was reading the word of all those fine Levite names and such? Were we still worshiping? Yes. Do you think it was because of where our hearts were at instead of our physical posturing? Yes. It's because of where our hearts were at. We were internally posturing. We were turning our focus. We were listening, paying attention to the inspired word of God. And external posturing isn't always needed. Because remember, it always comes down to the heart. So every once in a while, the pastor or somebody will ask you to stand in honor of God's word. And that's a great thing. Everybody stands in honor of God's word. But it isn't always necessary for proper worship if you are posturing inside correctly. Go ahead, Mike.
Yeah, there's different types of worship, too. I mean, this type of worship we're studying. And sometimes studying is better when you're buckled down and sort of seated and in looking at things, whereas other type of worship, more of an outward type worship, where you're all standing up and somebody is proclaiming in front of you, it's like a different type of situation. So, there's all kinds of different situations. And there was the situation before where no scripture at all was being read when they were building the walls, but they were still worshiping.
It always comes down to the heart. And as our brother said, there are different types of worship. But the main thing is to have your heart in the correct place. It says, because posture of the heart is most important, that's paramount, we should not concentrate on externals. It is very nice if you take your Bible, and I am not making light of other traditions, but if you are not nude in the presence of your Bible, if you're completely had proper attire, you're respectful around it, you carried it everywhere, you read it in a clear, beautiful voice, all that stuff's fine and dandy. Those are externals of worship. Is it possible to do externals without the internal? I see some nods. It very well is to get so wrapped up in tradition that you do the tradition by rote. You know what to do, so you just do it and not have any internal involved. Again, I'm not making light of anything and no disrespect, but sometimes someone could really care less. By that, I mean they're not focusing on it. If they thought about it, they would care. But there are times people just, they know what they're supposed to do, so they just do it, and there's no internal worship involved. Now, that I am not saying that good habits are not a good thing to have. That helps keep you out of trouble, keep you out of sin, keeps you from falling into pits. That's what you strive for anyway, are good, clean habits. But when you're doing acts of worship, it's important to have the heart involved. It's paramount. It says, respect is key, both internally and externally. And as individuals express this differently, as their brother said, different ways to do it, it says, It is noteworthy here that the people stood for 6 hours from daybreak till noon. And they were showing that as a significance of deep respect. This is one of the first times many of them had ever heard this. They're showing deep respect. It asks, what other postures of praise are listed in the verses that we just read? Are there any other external things that if someone was there, they could have seen the posturing of prayer? Does anybody see where it says bowing down with faces to the ground?
Well, they lifted their hands.
Lifted their hands. They celebrated with great joy, yes. Did any of them declare amen? You ever heard that uttered in church? Sometimes even at the prompting of the one who's giving the word. Amen, brothers and sisters. Amen. Yes. And all God's people said, amen. You hear different promptings for it even. Then it asks the question, how comfortable are you with individuals expressing praise in corporate worship, such as spontaneously standing or declaring amen or speaking in tongue? How comfortable are you with some of that? That could be a reflection question if you don't want to say anything. Do you think that makes some people uncomfortable sometimes? And if so, why? Any thought? Why would that make a Christian uncomfortable if another Christian stood up and started doing something? Even if it was just a simple hands. Heard a comedian say you do the TV. Or you do the widescreen. Or you do the hold up. Yep. Or you do the antenna. You ever heard some of those? Or you do the touchdown. Yeah. Somebody stands up and starts doing different things. Why would that make someone else uncomfortable? Any thoughts on that? Yeah, they're personality type. They might be more reserved to start with. Well, it could be a little bit of pride too, yes. They don't want to look foolish themselves. They may not understand any of that either. If they're newer to church, you come in new and you sit down, somebody next to you stands up, start going, amen, brother, and they start doing the, you know, revolving antenna. You're just like, what is that guy doing? So it might be a little bit overwhelming for someone at first. Distracting even. They just don't understand it. It can make them uncomfortable. Yeah, it says they bowed down with their faces to the ground, declared amen, they lifted hands. It says, why did the people mourn and weep when they heard the word? They started reading the law and the word to these people, what God expects, and they started to weep and mourn.
Because they became more aware of their sins, how they were failing God, yep. And shame.
Yes, yep.
They also might have missed that if some of them had the memory of it, you know, and now here it is, those sweet words are being spoken again, and yep. Even though they're crying, it somewhat tears of joy, but still... There's a sadness to it as well.
Mm-hmm. Yep, could have been a mixture of both. In this text, they're using the majority of it, though, because a lot of them had not heard this. But our brother's right, if some had heard it, it could have been sweet music to their ears. But there are a vast majority that hadn't heard it, that had fallen away. And as our other brother said, too, it was a glaring example of how they were not living right. When you're confronted with God's holiness, you can see how unholy you are, how far you are missing the mark. And when they saw that, they were very upset. Here they had done this great work, rebuilt these walls. They knew God had provided for them. Again, they did it in record time. They even had two pagan kings help them. The Jews did the work, but God had even used pagan kings to help them, one to give the permission and another to supply. So they knew God was large and in charge, and now they found out how far they'd been missing the mark. It can be very overwhelming. It says, when we are confronted with God's holiness in juxtaposition to our inner hearts. So when we are confronted with God's holiness compared to the sin in our inner hearts, it says the gap brings confession and sorrow, if you're being honest. So it asks, why did Nehemiah and the Levites urge the people not to grieve? So after they had been grieving for a bit, they instructed them not to grieve. Any thoughts on that?
Because that time was a time to celebrate God's provision and not mourn.
Yeah, that is exactly right for the traditional part of it, yep. It was the Feast of Trumpets. It was the time of the Feast of Trumpets. And it was a time for celebration of God's blessings on their harvest. It says the Levites knew the date, but the vast majority were ignorant of it, and that this was a time set apart in celebration of what God has done. So it also then reemphasizes their ignorance and neglect of the word and following God's law for years. They had neglected to read, and if they couldn't read, to at least get somewhere where somebody would read and teach them. They had neglected the word and had not followed it so long. A lot of them were just ignorant of this. But they were honest in their sorrow. That was a beautiful thing. I'm sure it honored the Lord. Now, how does that apply today? Go ahead.
I was also going to say that, they celebrated because they now understood the words.
Mm-hmm.
Now they understand it. And when you find something out, it's like it's a new present.
It is,
it's,
yeah.
It's something great.
It's a whole new world.
Yeah.
They say Helen Keller, when she finally understood what water meant, you've probably heard that story. They're trying to get through to her. And when she finally understood that, she put it together, what that person was trying to teach her with her hand, how to spell it out, say it in a sense with sign language, and that was water, the thing that she physically felt, she was overwhelmed. She finally got it. And that's what our brother's saying. When you finally get it, it can be such an eye-opener. It can open your whole life, your whole future, your whole decisions, your everything you're going to do, your whole destiny, your legacy can open so much up when you finally get it. But in today's world, we're not celebrating the Feast of Trumpets. Why is there a time to stop mourning and grieving and to express joy? If you've messed up and you realize how far you've missed the mark, yes, you should be sorrowful. You should be sad. You should mourn and grieve. There should be gnashing of teeth. But why is there a time to get up and to express joy? Any thoughts on that? To not just stay there. What do you think? Mr. Mike?
Because God is good and he's not going to leave you there.
Exactly.
Where you were.
Yep. He is a God of love. Yes, you do not want to be outside his will. But when you find out how far you've missed the mark, God says, my grace is sufficient. Did you not say that to Paul, for those that are familiar with that? Paul asked repeatedly for God to remove a thorn from his side, something he was struggling with, a particular sin in a sense. God said, my grace is sufficient. There's something else that Paul needed to learn, something he needed to depend upon, and this has been studied for years and years and talked about. But God told him, my grace is sufficient. It's the same thing when you talk about Satan. He is a thorn in our sides. He is an enemy of each and every one of us. But God's grace is sufficient. Yes, he could just right now remove him from the scene. Yes, total command over Satan. But God says, my grace is sufficient. So when you realize how badly you've messed up, what's been going on, and yes, you will hit the ground and you will be sorrowful. But as our brother said, God isn't going to leave you there. He wants better for you. He wants you to get up and repent, turn, be filled with joy for what God has done. His grace is sufficient, and move forward correctly. Man, that's like, there are 30 different sermons and all of that we just mentioned. So instead of mourning, they were encouraged to focus on hope and God's grace. God does not leave you there. So sometimes we need to cast aside our funeral clothing and put on garments of praise, because the joy of the Lord is our strength. Okay, last reading. This one's much shorter. Nehemiah chapter 9, verses 1 through 3. Anybody, any takers on that? And I don't think there are any names in it that you have to do the tongue twisters. Chapter 9, verses 1 through 3. Miss Tracy?
On the 24th day of the same month, the Israelites gathered together, fasting and wearing sackcloth, and putting dust on their heads. Those of the Israelite descent had separated themselves from all foreigners. They stood in their places and confessed their sins and the sins of their ancestors. They stood where they were and read from the book of the law of the Lord their God for a quarter of the day, and spent another quarter in confession and in worshiping the Lord their God.
Yes. It says only 24 hours later, 2 days after the Festival of Tabernacles concluded, the people returned to hear the word again. This time they came prepared for a different kind of worship. So they were told not to grieve, to go away in joy and celebrate what the Lord has done. Now they're coming back with a different kind of worship. So it asks, what was their preparation for worship? And how do we know they came for a specific purpose of confession and repentance? How do we know they came for confession and repentance? Go ahead.
They were dressed for it.
Yes. They had fasted. They are in sackcloth. They're throwing dust on their heads. All of these were traditions at the time. We don't usually generally do such traditions today, but there were traditions at the time to show great distress. And they were using those to show their distress over their sins, and they were confessing and repenting. So it asks the question, how do we prepare for worship before we come in? Or before you turned on your computer screen or your phone or however you're watching this today, how did you prepare for worship? Any thoughts on that? How do Christians prepare for worship before they arrive or before they plug in? Any thoughts on that? I get my coffee. Of course, I do that anyway. Yeah, I get fully caffeinated. Maybe that's why I can't stand still up here. Yep. Is there anything special you think anyone does or that you do to get prepared?
A little bit of morning quiet time.
Yep, some reflection.
Yeah, so you're not the one doing all the thinking, but you're doing more hearing than,
yes,
than thinking.
Yep.
I print and fold the bulletin.
Yeah, Brother Mark does the bulletin. Yep. Myself, I need to get myself out of the way. So as our brother Mike had said too, I reflect, but I ask God to move me out of the way. Anything that would distract me, I don't want to sound smart. I don't want to sound anything. I want to be plugged into what God has to say. So somewhere, someone has needed to hear what was being said today so far, and may it all be pleasing to our Lord. But I ask him to prepare his servant and get me out of the way of me. I need to be less, he needs to be more. And then I ask the same thing as John does the sermon. I ask him to get myself out of the way. I don't want to be thinking about lunch. I don't want to be distracted by what's out in the window, what's going on outside. There are times I might look just because I see motion, but I'm quick to come right back. I want to give my undivided attention. So how you prepare yourself is very important. If a person, I don't want to use the word just, but if a person shows up on Sunday morning out of habit, and that's all it is habit, they might need to reflect a little bit. That's between you and the good Lord. I am not judging your spirituality. But you might want to reflect a little bit, as Brother Mike said, and get yourself out of the way and get properly prepared for worship. So I don't want to beat that horse, but it's important to be properly prepared, postured inside even more than outside. We wear the proper clothes. We do and say the proper things. We smile, but be prepared inside. So here's kind of a reflection. It says, what does your Sunday morning pre-church look like? And how is it difficult to prepare for worship? It can be difficult at times to prepare for worship. That's, you can kind of reflect on that. That's your own walk with God, your own relationship. And of course it asks, what steps can you take to be able to gear your mind and your heart more towards meeting God? Now it says, through the meaning of repent, though the meaning of repent includes godly sorrow and regret. So these people felt sorry for their sins, how badly they've missed the mark. And here's an important point for a lot of Christians to really pick up. It goes farther, and it actually emphasizes the act of turning away. Now we've heard this. If you've been in the church long enough, you've heard of repent, and that it means to turn. It says a repentant sinner makes a 180-degree turn from sin into a relationship with God. So let me ask this. By their actions and these last few verses, how did it show, besides feeling bad about it, how did it show that they had started to repent? That they were turning away? Do you see anything in there in the verbiage? Because I will say this, repenting, true repentance involves action. It's not just feeling bad about it. That's important, to feel bad about it. You've transgressed against a holy God who cannot have sin before him. You can call it, you can say what you want, that I slipped, I tripped, I fell. You can code it in any way that you want. The fact is sin cannot be with God. So it's appropriate to feel bad about it. But do you see anything in here, any action that they took? And verse 2. Those of Israelite descent had separated themselves from all foreigners. Remember, they had been adulterous, and they had been going into foreign lands. They had taken wives and husbands and intermarried. They had taken on pagan rules, thoughts, values, and beliefs. So this meant not just physically, but inside, they were rebuking all of that. But they did physically separate themselves from all foreigners. They weren't just feeling bad. They were taking an action. That's important to remember with repentance. This turn of 180, you get up, dust yourself off, you pick up your mat, and you walk away. That's what Jesus told people to do. Get up. Pick up your mat. Walk away. Don't look back like Lot's wife. Don't pine for it in your heart. It's important. It says, we do not keep on sinning. It says, Ezra chapter 9, verses 1 through 4, it reveals their specific sin is intermarriage and intermingling with unbelievers. Now, it's important to get out there to unbelievers and bring Christ, but you do not want to pick up their habits and become like them. You're still an alien. Now, I'd ask the question, how does Nehemiah chapter 9, verses 1 through 2 show that the people have repented? Again, they had separated from the non-Jews. It was an act. It was an action. Now, what was the order of events in verse 3? Anybody see an order to the events? As John says, coming in for a landing. Do you see kind of an order to the events? And one that we should follow today? It says, one, they confessed and worshiped. And it was followed, two, by more reading of the law. So today we are to confess and worship and get in the Word. It's a pretty simple formula. Get in the Word. Now, I know people don't like to confess. I don't like to admit when I have done something. But my Monday men's group in particular, it's exactly what you do. You bear it. You get it out there. You shine the light of Christ on it. That ugly little rat can't hide. And, of course, nobody wants to do that. I remember reading a story about Arnold Schwarzenegger when he found out that he was too fat. The only time he ever came in second place, Sergio Olivier beat him in a Mr. Universe contest. Only time he came in second place. He had too much of a midsection. He was too fat. And his calves weren't big enough. So what did he do? Did he hide it like a lot of Christians do if they have a shortcoming? I don't want to tell everybody I struggle with lust. I don't want to tell everybody I gossip. They probably already know. But I don't want to tell everybody. Well, what did he do? He went transparent. He cut his shirts. So he walked around in public with his midriff showing. He cut his pants. Now, this is an extreme way of doing it, but it's an example of transparency, of confession. He's getting it out there. I need to work on this. And it propelled him, it compelled him to work on it. And in a very short order, he got it into shape. He was never beat. He's been number one in the contest ever since that he was in. But he went transparent. So as a Christian, don't hide. Get it out there. Find someone you can trust, someone who's not struggling in that area, whatever your area is. Confess it. Get it out there. Say, brother, sister, I'm struggling with this. And then they know how to pray and help you. And then repent. Do you have something, Mike? I thought you had something you were going to. Yeah. Then repent.
I was just looking at the order of things there, I think. And, you know, they repented, and then they worshiped the Lord their God at the very end. And I just wonder what that worship looked like. And I know it, maybe some of it was scripture, but maybe some of it was like raising hands and praising and singing and that kind of a thing as well. So they ended it kind of like they did the previous day, joy in the worship.
That's a beautiful thing to say, too. Yep, because as the songs say, the storms come in the night, but joy comes in the morning. You have the storm of all that sin, the storm of the confession, but you have the release and the joy that comes afterwards, as our brother said. So they were caught up in the joy of worship. It's a beautiful thing. It says the Israelites honored the word by standing for its reading for hours. So here's some reflection things to end with. These are ways that you can prioritize the scripture. One way is bringing your Bible to church and actively reading along. I most of the time depend, sometimes I will look it up, but a lot of times, thank God they've been putting it in the overheads and on the screens, and it's a great tool to have. But if you feel more connected by taking that action, it helps you focus better. You can bring in a Bible to church and actively read along. You could commit to a designated time and place to read the Bible in your home or elsewhere. You can write scripture on 3x5 cards and place them on mirrors or desks. Keep one in your wallet or in your pocket for key verses that might help you with any struggle that you're having. You can commit to memorizing a verse, especially what they call your life verse, a key verse. I've noticed a lot of people who I would call successful Christians, people who are not perfect, obviously, by any means, but yet are walking the walk so much cleaner and better than almost anyone else I know. Almost 100% of the time, they have a key verse, a life verse. John Trotter has one. Jeanette Trotter has one. Buddy of mine, Robert Bates, has one. These people are the cleanest walking people that I have personally met, that I know of personally. I don't know a lot of other people's histories and things and what they're struggling with right now, but concentrate on memorizing a verse, especially a key life verse. It says choosing a family verse. What they mean by this is you say it at dinner time, a short verse, because your kids are going to right away get that glazed over look if you start into, well, we're going to do the 23rd Psalm, you know, something long, just a key verse, something to mention at supper time or dinner times or meetings. And, of course, joining a Bible study group, very important. So any other closing thoughts or comments today? As usual, there's so much to learn and apply. I feel really juiced by today's session. It really fires me up. Okay, we'll go ahead and close in prayer. We don't want to be in here too long, have somebody come walking up because then they feel uncomfortable. So we're using the corporate space for this meeting, for this group. Anybody want to pray us out today? I'll take a volunteer if they want to. Otherwise, I would gladly do it. All right, let's bow our heads. Our Lord, our God in heaven, thank you for reaching out to us in your creation, always seeing us where we're at, always pulling us along, always improving us, providing for us. You said your grace is sufficient, and it is, God. Please help us this week to develop a better habit, to get it in our minds what we can do to get closer to you and prioritize your scripture. Help us this week. Holy Spirit, please come to our minds. Help us to see where we can do this. This will not only help us personally with our walk, but it will bless others so much. So help us with all of this, Holy Father, please. We ask your blessings upon John as he brings the message today. Help us to be mentally prepared and ready, as we discussed, for that part of worship. And bless the singers and everyone involved as we worship together today. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We have about a half hour of music. Here I am to say that.
time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what. Of My one defense, my righteousness.
been with you. And here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above.
morning, everyone. How are we doing this Sunday? Excellent. Obviously, I'm not Pastor John. He's coming in just a little bit late from Lost Lake, so he'll be here very shortly. But I wanted to open this up in Scripture. So starting with Psalm chapter 23, verses 1 through 6. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. If you'll join us, we'll now move into song, starting with You Never Let Go. So if you would rise if you're able, and we will get started.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. Even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near. And I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh no, you never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go in every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go. And I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. A glorious light beyond all compare. And there will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, we'll live to know you are here on earth. And I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh no, you never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go in every high and every I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. And there will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you. Yes, I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. There will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you. Oh no, you never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go in every high and every low. Never let go of me. Oh no, you never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go in every high and every low.
Our next scripture is from Matthew chapter 6, verses 25 through 34. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food, and the body more important than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Who of you, by worrying, can add a single hour to their life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the lilies of the field grow? They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon, in all his splendor, was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown in the fire, he will not much more clothe you, O you of little faith. So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own.
I have what you need, but you keep on searching. I've done all the work, but you keep on working. When you're running on empty, and you can't find the remedy, just come to the well. You can spend your whole life chasing what's missing, but that empty inside just ain't gonna listen. When nothing can satisfy and the world leaves you high and dry, just come to the well. And all who thirst will thirst no more, and all who search will find what their souls long for. The world will try, but it can never fail. So leave it all behind and come to the well. So bring me your heart, no matter how broken. Just come as you are when your last prayer is spoken. Rest in my arms a while, you'll feel the change, my child, when you come to the well. And all who thirst will thirst no more, and all who search will find what their souls long for. The world will try, but it can never fail. Leave it all behind and come to the well. Leave it all behind. The world will try, but it can never fail. So leave it all behind. And now that you're full of love beyond measure, your joy's gonna flow like a stream in the desert. Soon all the world will see living water is found in me, 'cause you've come to the well. And all who thirst will thirst no more, and all who search will find what their souls long for. The world will try, but it can never fail. So leave it all behind and come to the well. leave it all behind and come to the well.
Well, this morning's message is on planning. How you doing with your planning these days? Has it become a challenge? It has become a challenge for everyone. But didn't you like how the scripture this morning from Luke that Kyle read talked about how we like to have everything all planned out? We like to know. I remember when Alyssa was little, prior to kindergarten, she would go to her closet and get all of her clothes laid out because she wanted to know what she was going to wear the next day. How many of you are like that? You really get into planning? Okay, Denny is. Some of you are like, it doesn't really matter. I'll just go to the closet. The light doesn't even have to be on. I'll just grab something to wear. Some of us are more spontaneous, and others of us are more plotter type. Jesus said, don't worry about your life, everything in it. Your Heavenly Father knows what you need before you even ask. So today we're going to delve into the deep well of Scripture today in Romans chapter 15. Before we do, let's spend some time in prayer. And I just want to call your attention to this point in the service where we are creative in how we give. Some of you will be giving online through the church website, the online giving option. Some of you will probably stop by the basket back there in the back and drop an offering in. Others will give differently, and that's fine. I want to thank you for your faithful giving this church year. Who would have thought that this is what we would be dealing with? But here we are, and thank you for your faithfulness. So let's pray and ask God to bless. Lord, thank you for your work in our lives. You're growing us. You are maturing us. We probably, none of us here would have chosen what's been happening in our world and how we've been personally affected. And yet, we're growing by this. And in some ways, Lord, you're teaching us to cast our net on the other side of the boat. Giving us new ways. You're stretching us, Lord, and in ways that sometimes defy logic. But Lord, we're going to come to you today and trust. We're going to plan, and we're also going to pray that, Lord, what you want to see done in this world, you're going to use us, and you're going to bring it to pass. Thank you for the opportunity we have to participate in your plan. And though our contribution may seem micro, we know that we're part of your macro plan. All of us working together to accomplish your will here on earth. So, Lord, thank you for the opportunity we have to give. It is one way that you are mobilizing resources to help those in other parts of the world and right here at home. So, Lord, we praise you today that you've invited us to partnership in the gospel with you, the good news. Lord, we honor you today, and we thank you for the privilege we have of giving. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. And you may be seated. Well, today we've got another song by, it's really... through Vacation Bible School. We're going to get a little taste of Vacation Bible School. And today, last week, you met Ananias, Pastor Nathan. This week, you're going to meet, we're going to get an interview with a ship captain. Remember that over there in Acts where the Apostle Paul was riding on a boat on his way to Rome, and there was a mighty storm came up, and they crash-landed on the island of Malta? You're not going to believe this, but we actually are going to get an interview with the captain of that ship. And so looking forward to that. But first, and here I had you sit down. This next song is not going to allow you to sit down because you got to do the motions. I'm sorry, Denny. Everybody on your feet. Let's get this song done. And then we're gonna get an interview with the ship captain that the Apostle Paul happened to be on that ship that day. And we're going to learn more about that. All right.
Okay, according to my ship manifesto, you are my passengers sailing to the heart of the Roman Empire. Welcome to the sea. I am your captain. I will be sailing this vessel today. Just to clarify, you are not prisoners. I don't see any chains on you. No? Very good then. Why do I ask? Well, this is not a passenger ship. We're hauling cargo and prisoners mostly. This isn't even sailing season, and honestly, I'm wondering how you even got permission to be on my ship today. But I suppose it doesn't matter. We have room for you, so you're welcome to stay. Should be a flawless journey, unless... What? No, nothing important. Just something a prisoner said. Guy by the name of Paul. He's chained up in the prisoner hold below you. He said our ship would sink and the cargo would float off and we shouldn't even be sailing today, but it's nothing to worry about. He's not even a sailor. Who are you going to trust? Some non-sailor or me? The guy who's read Sailing for Dum-Dums at least twice. Yeah. Besides, he's a prisoner. From what I heard, he's a Christian who got in a lot of trouble for talking about Jesus. Supposedly, God changed his heart from hating Jesus followers to actually becoming a Jesus follower. Well, if you know Roman law, you don't need me to tell you that the emperor doesn't want people following Jesus. He wants people following the Roman emperor. But anyway, Paul kept blah, blah, blahing about this Jesus guy. So he ended up arrested, and he's on his way to stand trial in front of Caesar himself. Would not want to be that guy. No, thank ye. Anyway, if we just ask that, in case we do incur bad weather, that you just stay below deck for your own comfort and safety, and enjoy your trip. Bad news, mates. It looks like we're heading into some nasty weather. The wind has picked up and we're beginning to take on a little bit of water below deck. We will probably have some rough seas to contend with. I sure hope that Paul guy wasn't right about what's coming our way. In any case, you should probably go ahead and review the brochure you were handed when you brought on board. So you've been shipwrecked. Now what? Good luck, folks. It's not looking good. We've been in this storm for 3 days and it just won't quit. We've tried everything we could think of. We've dropped sail. We've thrown cargo overboard and nothing has helped. I even lost my copy of Sailing for Dum-Dums. I was mad that it couldn't help me with the storm and I threw it at the clouds. I missed and hit the ocean instead. Anyway, I went to see if our prisoner was okay, and Paul said we should probably eat something to keep up our strength. That advice worries me. He also gave us good news and bad news. The bad news, Paul says, is the ship is going down. The good news is none of us will drown. Paul says Jesus will take care of us all. He says Jesus' power gives us hope. I'm not sure how Jesus could help us, but maybe Paul knows something that we don't. But here's my trouble. If we wreck, I'm supposed to kill the prisoner so he can't get away. But he's helped us. He's given us food. He said his friend Jesus will take care of us, so maybe I should let him live. I'll have to figure that out later. For now, grab something that floats. And follow me to the top deck. I'm relieved to see you made it to shore. It was scary the way the ship splintered apart and sank, but Paul was right. Not one person on our ship was lost. Boy, trusting in Jesus sure gave us hope in that shipwreck. I hope you keep on trusting in Jesus to give you hope, no matter what you face, too. I think I'm going to try. In fact, I think I know of a book that could help me with that. Trusting Jesus for Dum-Dums.
That was Pastor Nathan. He will be bringing the message next Sunday morning.
You're invited to stand and join with us. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the
King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. Into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You'd lay down your done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. Done for me.
Thank you, Christina, Kyle, Rob. Good to be back live. And tech team, thank you. I know there's things back there that happen that are out of our control. Computers freeze up. The service we had out at Lost Lake for the first time, we had our first computer freeze up during the service this morning, which cut the live stream off. We had to restart everything. So isn't that fun? Well, once there was a young woman who brought her fiancé home to meet her parents. And after dinner, the mother said, why don't you take, you know, our potentially future son-in-law into your study and, you know, ask him a few questions. So the father invited the fiancé back to his study to talk. And so he began, he said, "So what are your plans?" He said, "I'm going to be a biblical scholar." "Oh," said the father. "Admirable. Now, what are your plans for buying my daughter a beautiful wedding ring?" Young man said, "Well, I'm going to concentrate on my studies, and I just know that God's going to provide." "And good," he said. "How will you provide for my daughter a nice home to live in?" He said, "Well, I'm going to concentrate on my studies, and I'm going to be confident that the Lord will provide." So the father went a little deeper. He said, "So tell me, how are you going to help, you know, provide for kids when the time comes?" "I'm going to concentrate on my studies, and the Lord will provide." So later the mother came back to the father and said, "So honey, how'd the conversation go? What did you learn about our potential new son-in-law?" He said, "Well, I learned that he has no job, has no plans, and he thinks I'm God." How are you with planning? For some of you, it comes natural. You were a born planner. For others, we've had to learn the skill. And it is difficult sometimes. The Bible is actually full of plans. And we get encouragement by seeing that people not only are planners, but they're also subject to uncontrollable situations, kind of like we're experiencing in our world today. You may look at the situation and think it should be different, but bottom line, we're all being impacted by what's going on. So how are you doing with your planning? Let's look at Luke chapter 14 as we begin today. "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yet even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple." Now, Jesus is really getting down to where the disciples are going to have to make some choices. He says, "Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Will you not first sit down and estimate the cost and see if he has enough money to complete it? For if he lays the foundation and is not able to finish it, anyone who sees him will ridicule him, saying, 'This fellow began to build and was not able to finish.'" We learned a couple of weeks ago, as we here at Living Well are part of a global family called the Church of the Nazarene, we learned that, you know, of course, every 4 years we have a General Assembly, and the General Assembly Commission this year has postponed the General Assembly from 2021 to 2023. Now, let me give you some reasoning for that. Global travel has either been restricted or deemed unsafe. Embassies and consulates have been closed. We're talking people from 160 world areas. The dates for reopening remain uncertain for those embassies and consulates. Access to travel visas to the United States and through transit points have been delayed. Financial challenges at the local church level have impacted the district's ability to budget for the upcoming General Assembly. Think about the macro plan that has to be in place in order for you and me to pack our bags and go to General Assembly, the micro. I'm thankful there are people out there thinking about is it even possible for our denomination to gather everybody, 30,000 to 50,000 people? Is it possible for us to do that in these circumstances? And so there's been a delay. The truth of the matter is the Bible teaches us that planning is good. But we should also be careful about the emphasis that we put on planning, remembering that God is ultimately in control. I love over there in James chapter 4 where it says, those of you who say, hey, let's go to this city or that city and we'll spend a year or two there and make awesome money and come back. And James says, wait a minute. He said, you ought to say as Christians, if it's the Lord's will, we will go to this city or that city and make money and come back. So today is our next to the last sermon from our series, Keys to Your New Life. Next week, Pastor Nathan will be bringing us in for a landing with a sermon called The Last Word, Amen, chapter 16 of Romans. So today we're going to look at Romans chapter 15. If you have your Bibles and would like to turn there, I'm going to read Romans 15, 23 through 33. I don't think it's on the screen, but that's fine. I didn't have it up there for us anyway. So chapter 15, 23 through 33. But now there is no more place for me to work in these regions, and since I have been longing for many years to visit you, I plan to do so when I go to Spain. I hope to see you while passing through and to have you assist me on my journey there after I have enjoyed your company for a while. Verse 25. Now, however, I'm on my way to Jerusalem in the service of the Lord's people there for Macedonia and Achaia. We're pleased to make a contribution for the poor among the Lord's people in Jerusalem. They were pleased to do it, and indeed they owe it to them. For if the Gentiles have shared in the Jews' spiritual blessings, they owe it to the Jews to share with them their material blessings. So after I have completed this task and have made sure that they have received this contribution, I will go to Spain and visit you on the way. Do you see some planning involved in Paul's life? He's working through a plan. I know that when I come to you, I will come in the full measure of the blessing of Christ. Verse 30, I urge you, brothers and sisters, by our Lord Jesus Christ and by the love of the Spirit, to join me in my struggle by praying to God for me. Pray that I may be kept safe from the unbelievers in Judea, and that the contribution I take to Jerusalem may be favorably received by the Lord's people there, so that I may come to you with joy by God's will, and in your company be refreshed. The God of peace be with you all. Amen. Way back in the first chapter of Romans, we remember that Paul had intended to visit Rome for years. He wanted to get there. It was his intention. He was sending communication to the church in Rome that his plans were to come to Rome to visit. Romans chapter 1, verse 13 says, now I don't want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, that I often plan to come to you, but was prevented until now. Romans 1, 15, so I'm eager to preach the gospel to you who are in Rome. As we take this scripture this morning, I believe that there are going to be some principles that are going to jump out to you, that you're going to say, I could really use that for where I'm at in my life right now in relationship to planning. So I want you to be looking for that as the Holy Spirit leads us this morning. The first thing that we see in the Apostle Paul's ministry and as it relates to planning is that he had already won many, many, probably hundreds, if not thousands of people, Gentiles, non-Jews, to the Lord Jesus Christ. But one thing that we find in our scripture this morning is that Paul, although he's enjoyed success, he is still giving all credit to God. So let's start there. A good plan starts and ends with God's plan for the world. Can you hear me all the way back? A good plan starts and ends with God's plan for the world. It means that as we start out in our lives, and you could be 75 today and planning your life for the first time with Christ at the center, and you could be 16 today. You could be thinking, who should I marry? What should I do? What kind of career choices should I make? Remember that a good plan starts and ends with God's plan for the world. And we're going to spend more time on that in just a few moments. The Apostle Paul also points out to us that good planning, now he does it indirectly through his Spirit, that good planning starts with humility. Starts with humility. Those of you who are old enough to remember Muhammad Ali, remember that he was not famous for his humility. He was once on an airplane, you've probably heard this before, and he liked to refer to himself as Superman. So the flight attendant came to him and said, Mr. Ali, you're going to need to fasten your seatbelt. And he said, Superman don't need no seatbelt. And as quick as a flash, she responded, well, Superman don't need no airplane either. And so we need to cultivate the same attitude that the Apostle Paul had. That's humility. Amen. That our job is to join God in what He's already doing. The next thing that we can find is that it's helpful to do things that God loves to bless. Do things that God loves to bless. Now, Paul had shared his ministry priorities. There were a few things there. You know, he was wanting to get to Rome and he was wanting to get to Spain. And, you know, I don't know how familiar you are with your biblical history and biblical tradition and church tradition in regards to whether or not Paul actually made it to Spain after he got to Rome. Frankly, we're not sure, but we know that as Paul actually arrived at Rome, it was certainly a detour from what his original plan would have been. And all you got to do is look over there in the book of Acts and find that while Paul certainly had in his mind to get to Rome, it was through the ringer. In fact, as we heard from the ship's captain, Paul ended up shipwrecked on the island of Malta on his way to Rome, not because he was large and in charge, being a paying passenger, but because he was a prisoner. Paul, in fact, did make it to Rome, but it was not in a way that he would probably have planned. And so while it's important for you and I to make plans, it's also important to realize, and I used this morning, Bill, and thank you for dropping it in my mind first thing this morning, sometimes God asks us to be okay with dropping our net on the other side of the boat. And that, for some reason, that really hit me this morning, that that's exactly what's happening in our world today, in the church today. We have been fishing for so long on this side of the boat because, well, that's what we do. It's easy. We're all, you know, most of us are right-handed, so we put it on this side of the boat and we're able to leverage it up and it's all good. And then Jesus comes along and says, how you doing fishing? And we're like, nothing is out there. Jesus said, what? Well, cast your net on the other side. And we're like, that makes no sense at all. But out of obedience, they did so, and they cast the net on the other side, and what happened? The fish filled the net, and they were barely able to get it into the boat. As good as we have been planning and strategizing and working, God can somehow take the unpredictable events of life that crash our plans and make something beautiful out of them. Amen? So it's awesome to plan, but it's also awesome to prayerfully accept that when our plans get crashed and we are being asked to do something like cast our net on the other side, God's going to bring something amazing out of it because we do it in humility and obedience. So Paul also had an offering that he had received at Achaia in Macedonia that he wanted to take where? Back to Jerusalem. What was that about? Well, the people in Macedonia and Achaia were not Jewish primarily. They were Gentiles. Paul was very effective among the Gentiles. And he had received an offering. And by the way, for those of you who've been trekking with us all the way through Romans, we remember that there was a lot of discord between the Gentiles and the Jewish Christians at the church in Rome. And you can see that the Apostle Paul made it his priority that he receive an offering from the Gentiles to take all the way back to Jerusalem, because the people there were going to benefit from knowing that the Gentiles were going to approach ministry from a standpoint of humility and be givers and participants in the work of the church. It may have went a long ways, amen, to begin the relationship between the Jews and the Gentiles in bringing the church together. Believers in Jerusalem had shared the gospel with the Gentiles by sending out missionaries like Paul. Paul was looking at it as, you know, now it's the least the Gentiles can do to send an offering back to Jerusalem to let them know that we support them and care for them. They were going through a famine at that time. In fact, the higher echelons of society were even doing things intentionally to prevent the Jewish Christians from securing employment, and they needed help. So Paul made it a top priority in his ministry to personally carry this offering back to the church in Jerusalem. Now, these days, the pastor doesn't handle the money in the church, and I'm thankful for that. Amen. But I love how Paul was being transparent with the church, saying, I've got this offering, and I want to take it back to Jerusalem. What do we see there? We see that good planning is based on integrity, transparency, faith, and truth. Can I get an amen? Good planning is based on integrity, transparency, faith, and truth. Paul was being transparent with the church. He said, I've got this offering. I want to take it back to Jerusalem. Pray that the people in Jerusalem will receive it as intended. So, good planning question. As you and I are working to make a plan for our lives and for our church and the lives of our family, we ask the question, here's a good question. What would Jesus do? What would Jesus do? Because good planning is always in harmony with the values and goals of the kingdom of God. Here's another good question. How can I join God in what He's already doing? You see, the Apostle Paul was not making the church. Amen? It wasn't as though he had an awesome idea and God's like, that, Paul, is a great idea. Can I get an amen? The church was God's idea from the beginning. And so Paul said, oh, I'm going to join God in what He's already doing. And there was momentum already there, amen? As he joined God in what he was already doing, it's as awesome as Paul was, he wasn't that good. And as awesome as you and I are, we're not that good. We're joining God in what He is already doing. When we plan in tune with God's desires for this world, we will not be hindered by a guilty conscience, unnecessary baggage from poor moral choices, and shallow thinking. Nor will we be overcome by unmanageable weariness or enemies of the truth. Psalm 21:11 says, though they plan evil against you, and though they devise mischief, they will not succeed. Amen. Because when we're planning according to God's truth will prevail. Amen. Paul invites the recipients of this letter, the church in Rome, to join him, to strive with him together in fervent prayer. Let's look at Romans 15, 30 through 33. Now I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, through our Lord Jesus Christ and through the love of the Spirit, to strive together with me in fervent prayer to God on my behalf. Pray that I may be rescued from the unbelievers in Judea, that my ministry to Jerusalem may be acceptable to the saints, and that by God's will I may come to you with joy and be refreshed together with you. May the God of peace be with you all. Amen. Prayer is powerful because God is powerful. Amen. We need to bathe everything in prayer and everyone in prayer. You know, it kind of hit me this week. We probably all have friends and family that are still, as the Apostle Paul heard from Jesus, are still kicking against the goads, which is in Greek and Roman literature, that meant ruinous resistance. It meant vain resistance. It'd be like you standing in front of a tsunami and saying, I am going to stop this tsunami. That's my plan. And it just... Jesus asked the Apostle Paul, Paul, what are you doing on the road to Damascus? Paul, Paul, wake up. What are you doing? You're over there kicking against the goads. It hurts, doesn't it?
Yeah.
As he was humbled. Paul, what are you doing? Well, I got this plan. I'm going to eliminate some Christians today. Paul, my plan is to build the church, not destroy it. Paul, what are you doing? I'm kicking against the goads. It hurts, doesn't it, Paul? Yeah, it hurts bad. Well, Paul, stop. And that was his conversion. He stopped resisting the ultimate plan of God and decided to join God in what he was already doing. Amen? Now, of course, there's repentance there. Paul said, you know, I'm sorry. He became a follower and a child of God. So we've all got people in our lives that are still kicking against the goads, as you heard from Jesus. We still have people in our lives that are fighting this battle that cannot be won. Jeanette's family this last week lost a loved one to a drug overdose. And I remember just this week reading the Facebook post, and the mother of the child, the stepmother of the child, said, for those of you who partied with him, I hope that you learn something from this. It's impossible to enjoy success that is lasting and meaningful and eternal while any of us are creating a plan to do something that is outside of God's will for this world. So, did Paul ever make it to Spain? We know he made it to Rome. Some church tradition says that he was beheaded on his way out of Rome. Some church tradition, some early church fathers say that, yes, he did drop into Spain. And, you know, we're not sure. It's not in the biblical record, but it is in some early church history books. But anyway, did he make it to Spain? We're not sure. Did he make it to Rome? You bet he did. But not in the way he had planned. The way he had planned was, you know, a little more glorious, perhaps. But the way that it actually happened was step by step, just like working through the layers of government. If we were to start here at the local level and make it all the way to the president, God took the Apostle Paul through every layer of government in the Roman Empire, making a stop at every seat of authority to share the gospel in chains. It wasn't at all how Paul had it planned, but God used the circumstances to deliver on his promise that the good news will be shared with all the world. So, coming in for a landing here. Plan to do things that God can bless. Plan to do things that God can bless. That sounds so simple, and yet how many young lives get sidelined, get shipwrecked, because they've set out on a course to do something that God just cannot bless because it doesn't follow his values. It doesn't value truth. Second is another kind of no-brainer, but we all need to hear it. Good planning begins with God. It means that we start with, what do you want, God? And by the way, if you feel that's confining, oh my goodness, it will only open the horizon to incredible opportunity and incredible diversity and choices that you'll have never thought of. I just speaking for our years together as pastoring. When we do things God's way, it's just, it's fun, it's hard, but it's really, really fun. And it's amazingly creative and diverse, and by it's anything but boring. Amen? Can I get an amen? Amen? Finally, as we're coming in for a landing, prayer and planning go together. Prayer and planning go together. Something beautiful happens when we get on our faces before God and we pray. What's happening? We're getting back in touch with who God is and who we are, and everything comes in proper perspective. Amen. So don't try to plan without prayer. And if you pray, you're going to get a plan. Amen? Because God sees you as too valuable of a resource to leave you on the sideline. He's got a plan for you at every stage of life. Humility is a necessity. Prayer brings humility because we place ourselves and our ability to plan before God, the God of the universe. And there's no place to go but to our knees. Finally, God's plans are to prosper you as you plan to prosper the gospel. God says, so what's your plan? And you're like, well, I'm going to go off and do this or that. And he says, well, have you thought about, you know, my plan for the world? Well, that doesn't apply to me. I'm just going to go do this and that. God's slowing you down. And he's saying it does matter. Your plans really do matter. Number one, if you try to go off and do something that's outside of my will, you're not going to succeed. Now, you may succeed by the world's definition today, but you will not succeed, because it is against the truth. That's sobering, isn't it? But God says, I have a plan for you, and I have a plan to prosper you. Well, what's that? Prosperity in the gospel is, it may not be what we would consider in this world the definition of prosperity, with money and gold and bling, houses and land. But prosperity in the gospel sense is fulfilling the beautiful will and plan of God. Paul says, I learned that the hard way. And we all did, to a certain extent, learn it the hard way, didn't we? Because it came through repentance. God has a plan for us, and it's a plan to prosper us and to bring us success. Success in what? God's plan. So let's join him in what he's already doing. Amen. Oh, we got to read Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you. Can I get an amen? Woo! Plans to prosper you and not harm you. Your soul will be healed through this. It's going to hurt, but it will be worth it. I'm going to ask you through this crazy time in life to cast your net on the other side of the boat, and you'll go, what? But my plans are to prosper you. And you're going to receive hope, and you're going to have an awesome future. Because you're joining me in truth. You're joining me in my plans for this world to bring total redemption and salvation. I'm so thankful that our God loves us and he has good plans in place for us. I love what you guys named the building, Plans to Prosper. It's God is blessing. Not only is this little place here kind of a small business percolator, but it's also been a tremendous blessing to the church. Thank you for your investment, joining God in what he's already doing. Just talking to our landlords here. Love you guys. I don't want to embarrass you, but can you blame me for including that in this sermon? I mean, it's like right here, it's the elephant in the room. Look what God's doing as we join him in what he's already doing. May God be praised. Let's pray together. And then Rob and Lynette are going to share with us what a friend we have in Jesus as we close. Lead now, we pray, Lord, as all of us seek to do your will and work in this world today. Lord, help us not get out there where we're so fixed on our plan that we throw our fist on the table and say, come what may, I'm going to get this done. Lord, feel free to adjust our determination. Don't water us down. Don't temper us, Lord, but help us put our faith and trust in you and not our ability to plan and foresee the future, because really that's something that it's not a tool in our toolbox. Help us trust you, Lord, for the future and go along with adjustments. And when our pride is wounded because our plans fail, may you build us up and bring good out of even our mistakes and our failures. Lead now, we pray, knowing that not only are you seeking to bless and honor and give us hope and a future, but you're walking with us as a friend. What a friend we have in Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen. After our song by Rob and Lynette, we're going to come back together and sing the doxology as we dismiss it. Thank you. Robin Lynette. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Oh, what pain we often go through. I like how that song kind of grabs that part of life and says we don't have to go through all that. Sometimes we can, by making good choices and a good plan through prayer, God has a different way for us, a way that we're not kicking against the goads and hurting ourselves. All right, let's stand together as we sing the doxology. So before we sing, are there any disappointments that you might need to bring to God today in prayer? Any events that have happened, whether it be 30 years ago or something that happened just last week, crashed your plans? Is there any frustration with, man, if this person would just get their act together, my life would be so much better? Is there any of that you need to give to God today? Is there any just frustration with stuff in life right now? Because it's cramping your style and forcing you to do things differently. Let's join God in what he's doing through this. I think he's, in some way, he's inviting us to throw our net on the other side of the boat, which is awkward and uncomfortable, but yet it may be very productive for the kingdom as we do that. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. The Spirit of the Lord has been here this morning. I know that because I know I've been challenged. Maybe you got away with life as normal, but I didn't. Thank you for being who you are, for giving your gifts and your talents into the work of the kingdom, for making those investments, and for knowing and trusting that God is going to bring good, even if it seems like life's coming apart right now, in your micro life, or even the macro, as it looks on the news, you know. Lord, bring something good out of this, we pray. Oh, he will. He will. Amen. Let's join him in what he's doing as a church. Have a great week. May God bless you. We're going on vacation. Did I tell you that? We're going on vacation. We're going to go stare at the water for a few days. Okay. I mean, that's our plan. We are taking an RV, so it could be very different than our plan. Yeah, God willing. That's right.